healthcare. It's interesting, the last column of Breaking the Sound Barrier, this is a book of my columns that I've just published with great thanks to Dennis Moynihan, who edits everyone every week, is about healthcare. And now the border guards in Canada know about our healthcare system as well, because it was Thanksgiving when I was on a book tour, and I was headed from Seattle to Vancouver. Usually we do fundraisers for community media that broadcast to Mars Now. There I was going to speak at the Vancouver Public Library and do a fundraiser for the three community radio stations that broadcast Democracy Now! In Vancouver. And a huge shout out to, well, the Pacifica station, WPFW 89.3 FM. And to Morgan State Radio, WPFW. Democracy Now! Every morning at 88.9 FM. Also, if you watch Baltimore Public Access Channel 75 every morning at 8 and every evening at 6, Democracy Now! Is the largest public media collaboration in the country, the only one to broadcast simultaneously on TV and radio and on the internet every day across the United States and around the world. So when you were all eating turkey on Thanksgiving, we decided to talk turkey in Canada. And we were driving over the border in Vancouver, me and two of my colleagues, my editor Dennis and another friend, and the Border Patrol stopped us, as they do everyone. We handed over our passports, but we were not going to move so fast. They told us to pull over, and we went into the big border facility crossing, like a big gymnasium. And they called me up. They said, "Amy, step forward." And I came up, and they said, "What will you be talking about today?" I was very surprised. They said, "We want to see your notes now." Now, this is the thing about my talks, as you will see, is I don't really speak from notes. I explained that. They didn't believe me. So I went after the car, and I got the book, and I handed it to the guards, all armed in front of me. One of them started to read through it, and I said, "I really just read excerpts of columns, and I sort of riff on them." One of them was writing everything I said in a computer, another was handwriting, and the other had a book. And they said, "What are you going to be talking about tonight?" I said, "I'm going to start with the last column." You know, it was a public lecture, and I did invite them to come. I didn't want to give them the order. The lecture the column was called "Healthcare Reform Needs an Action Hero." And I told them, it's about Tommy Douglas. They, unlike probably most of you, know who Tommy Douglas is because he's considered the greatest Canadian. He was the premier of Saskatchewan in the early 60s because when he was a child, he almost lost his leg, but because of a doctor's generosity and saying, "If you would be willing to be viewed by medical students, I will treat you for free." He understood what it meant for there to be medical treatment for all, and he pioneered single-payer health care, Medicare, throughout Canada. First brought it to Saskatchewan in the early 60s. His major opposition, believe it or not, was the American Medical Association, the AMA. He took them on for something like a 23-day strike. Why would they come to Canada and care? Because they were afraid the contagion would spread south. But he won. And it was so popular so fast that it was adopted by all of Canada very quickly. The CBC did a 2004 poll and called Tommy Douglas the greatest Canadian. And I'm explaining this at the border to these border guards. And they said, "I mean, you're Sarah Palin, you just let her in, and she is here castigating you, ripping apart your health, because I'm here to applaud it." It didn't help. And the reason I was writing about it was because Tommy Douglas's grandson is someone we all know in the United States, Kiefer Sutherland, the actor, the star of 24, right? His mother is Shirley Douglas, his father, Donald Sutherland. And he actually speaks out eloquently for single-payer health care, just not south of the Canadian border. He spoke at a big rally in Alberta, Canada. He said, "Private health care doesn't work. America's trying to change their system. It's too expensive to get comprehensive medical care in the U.S. Why on earth are we going to follow their system here?" Kiefer Sutherland went on, "I consider it a humanitarian issue. This is an issue about what is right and what is wrong, what is decent and what is not." Now, Kiefer Sutherland speaks to a very right-wing audience in the United States as the star of 24. Rush Limbaugh says it's his favorite show, and I don't know how many of you watch 24, but he stars as Jack Bauer, the fictional rogue intelligence agent who invariably employs torture and a host of other illegal tactics to help the president fight terrorism. But when you look at the number of people who die in the United States every day, something like 50, terrorism is not the culprit. It's lack of healthcare. And that's why it's so important for Kiefer Sutherland to speak out. As I said at the end of the column, maybe Jack Bauer can save the day. Well, the border guards weren't smiling after I told them that story, and they said, what are you really talking about tonight? That's what I'm talking about. I'm going to talk about healthcare. What else, then, are you talking about? I said, well, I'll talk about the global economic meltdown. That's M-E-L-T-D-O-W. What else are you talking about, they said. I said, well, maybe this is the trigger. I will be talking about the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. What else are you talking about? Global warming. I'm going to talk about global warming. What else? I said, well, I really just have about an hour that pretty much sums up. And they said, you deny you're talking about the Olympics. In November, I wasn't sure what they were talking about. Anyone who knows me, I'm not a huge fan of, you know, organized sports, though I definitely like to engage in sports. I said, you mean when President Obama went to Copenhagen to try to get the Olympics in Chicago, and one of the border guards said, yeah, and you didn't get them. I know. I said, are you talking about Rio? No, we're talking about the Vancouver Olympics. I was a little embarrassed saying it wasn't really, that wasn't on my horizon. He said, and you're denying that you're going to be speaking about this. I said, well, I wasn't planning to speak about this. They didn't believe me. They sat me down, and they went through the car, bag by bag, suitcase by suitcase, computer by computer. Went going through all of our notes, opening our computers, going through a very serious compromise for a journalist. You're in a kind of no man's land, a kind of lawless area on the border. And finally, you know, we're desperately trying to call those radicals, the head of the Vancouver Public Library, to explain that we're trying to get there, and thank goodness for Canadians, they all went out for some beer and came back and packed the place 2 hours later. But it became a top story in Canada, you know, the CBC of all the newspapers that they had detained American journalists. And then I came to understand the severity of what was happening when you have this very serious corporate government nexus of power, the Olympics, which we don't usually think of in this way. The Vancouver City Council had passed laws that said that if you have a sign against the Olympics in your house, if your house could be raided, you couldn't speak out against the Olympics in downtown Vancouver. Athletes could not speak out about the corporations in any kind of negative way that were sponsoring the Olympics. Free speech is very important. It's what will protect us. It's what will secure us. And so this highlighted what they were dealing with. Well, you can be sure we came back to the United States. Well, we had to. They took photographs of us, four of each of us, stapled what they called control documents into our passports as there wasn't where we needed a visa to come into Canada. And so we had to leave the country within 48 hours. So back in New York, 48 hours later, we did a Democracy Now! Special on the Vancouver Olympics.